little less space, but I like it. Got good recesses, got the ability to hide what I'm doing up here a little bit. Not much you can hide in a room full of people, but it is what it is. It just feels a little bit better that you can't see that surface quite as well. It's the professional way. This is how the professionals do it. This is how it looks, as if there's nothing there, as it's all in their head and they have this perfect memory and everything just comes out at you. And no, we know better than that. We know that. And I'm going to let you in on a little secret. You ever see with the other guys, you see these little pieces of glass on each side and it looks like it's a nice little piece of glass. The little piece of little glass is what they call a teleprompter. The words are rolling on both sides, so you can look around and this side and this side and look through the glass at the people, and people swear, oh, he's so smart. It's all coming at him, and it's all sitting right there rolling off. Technology is amazing. We humans are still sinful and bad. It is what it is. I tell you what is amazing, though, coming back from the feast. We come back from this amazing spiritual feast, and as soon as we get back, Satan comes right back in, swoops right back in, reclaiming any problems that we may have had beforehand, and throws them right back up in our faces and says, you all haven't changed a bit. Nothing happened down there that I can't break off anytime I want. Satan comes right back in and reclaims us and gets us immediately to go right back to those same old habits, those same old sins that we thought we left behind. Which proves all those people that say, oh, I can step on his head. I can break him off. Oh, I ain't scared of him. It doesn't bother me. Got bad news for you. He's not afraid of you either. And he can have you anytime he wants to. And he proves it so many times. But we have warnings. Let's drop anchor. James, the 3rd chapter, the 10th verse. James, the 10th chapter, the 3rd, 10th verse, where it says, out of the same mouth proceeds blessing and cursing. My brothers, these things ought not to be. Does a fountain send forth at the same hold the sweet and the bitter? Can the fig tree, my brothers, bear olive berries or a vine figs? So no fountain can yield both salt water and fresh. Who is wise and knowing among you? Let him show his works by his good conduct with meekness or wisdom. But if you have bitter jealousy and strife in your hearts, do not glory and lie against the truth. This is the wisdom coming down from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish. For where envying and strife are, there is confusion and every foul deed. But the wisdom that is from above is first truly pure, then peaceable, gentle, easy to be entreated. In other words, you get into an argument, it's easy to convince them. Let's talk about this. Let's get this thing straight. Full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace. By whom? By those who make peace. The tougher times get, the more evil the world becomes. That's not accidental. That's planned. And it's been planned, and we watch the plans every day and revel in them. As I said, the times get tougher and the more evil it becomes. Well, notice what's on your television every day. The programming becomes what it is. You hear all the people who want to be apologists. Oh, no, 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 no. Art imitates life. No. We've reached a point where we've become so emptied of logic. We've become so emptied of a sure and pure way to go that art not imitates life, but puppifies life, fakes out life, drives life the way it wants it to go, tells people, this is how you should think. I remember a time you could turn on your television and hear things that were healthy, that you could buy them, that would make sense for you. Now it's almost as if the drug dealer is on there every hour of the day. Oh no, you mean the drug dealer? Yes, Big Pharma. Ask your doctor if you should have, wait a minute now, I'm the patient. I'm the one that is ill. I'm the one that is not well. I shouldn't be asking my doctor anything. I should theoretically walk in and he should be able, through his, all of the things that he has at his disposal and his years of experience, he should be able to, after 5 or 10 minutes and an examination, tell me this is wrong, that's wrong, that's wrong, that's wrong. Why should I be asking my doctor anything? Is what it is. But we have to understand it and see it for what it is. Why do you think they call it television programming? Because that's what Satan is doing to us. He's programming us by what he puts on television. And we, after a while, how many times have you, the first time you heard a song, oh, I hate that. But about the 50th or 60th and an hour or two, you're like, you are being programmed. It is what it is. But that's what Satan does. We watch things on television and we hear things on the radio. We watch movies. We go to see plays. We see them at the theater. We are told to, in all of this, the Bible tells us to watch the world around us. But even the news that we're told to watch is programmed against us. We only see what Satan wants us to see and what he allows his networks to show us. We think of it in terms of CBS, NBC, ABC, Fox, but you should really just understand them for what they are. Satan's networks, because that's what they have become. The lie comes to us constantly, and we swear that we're being informed. But we can't avoid it. We've got to watch. Where else do we get the information from? We simply have to accept that we're being lied to and look between the lines to find the truth, wherever we can find it. There's no reason to be angry about it. We were warned of this. Yeshua had to deal with these same things from the religious leaders of his day, who were just as co-opted, just as sold out. Why do you suppose every time he went before the Pharisees, it was a face-to-face, and it wasn't, hey, buddy, how are you? Is everything okay? No, he was explaining things that they were doing wrong, and there were plenty to explain. But he did what he had to do. He called these dissemblers out face to face. Let's go to John, the 8th chapter, the 44th verse, 43rd verse. Let's go back one verse. John, the 8th chapter, the 43rd verse, where he starts with the question, why do you not know my speech? Because you cannot hear my words. He's not saying that you're not perceiving them orally. That's not what he's saying. What he's saying is, either you don't understand it or you don't believe. Because you cannot hear my word. You are of the devil as father, and the lusts of your father you will do. He was a murderer from the beginning and did not abide in truth because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it, the father of lies. Yet at one time, Hasatan was in the inner circle of God. He was a trusted member of the kingdom of heaven. He was trusted and counted and could be counted on to carry out the will of Elohim. But suddenly, something happened. He looked around and saw all that he could do and began to think, hey, I can do this. I can probably do it better than he can. He became vain and came to the conclusion that he could do a better job of ruling the universe than God Almighty. And then he set out to do so. Let's go to Isaiah, the 14th chapter, the 12th verse. Isaiah, the 14th chapter, the 12th verse, where it says, how you have fallen from the heavens, O shining star, son of the morning. How you are cut down to the ground, you who weakened the nations, and they think they're strong. For you have said in your heart, I will go up to the heavens. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will also sit on the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. In other words, I'm going to sit among the people and influence them against you. In the sides of the north, I will go up above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. He's not saying I'm going to be the Most High. He says I'm going to be as or like the Most High. In other words, I'm just as good as he is. His plan is always the same. Once you see it, anywhere else you see it, you should recognize it. It's always the same. He doesn't change because what he finds works. He's not constantly feeling the need to, well, let's try something different. No, that worked, we do it again. He did the same thing to turn a legion of the Almighty's angels against him. By the same method that he got Adam and Eve to doubt God and try to attain equal power and status with him. Here, notice the center of his enticement to them was not power alone, but the idea that Yahweh was somehow holding back something from them that Satan was offering freely. Equal power and the freedom to do whatever they wanted. What is Satan's big thing he's telling the world now? Do what you will is the only law. So that's why people just constantly want to believe that there is no law. Whether it be man's law, whether it be the Ten Commandments, whether it be the Constitution, doesn't matter what it was. Don't do that. Do what you want to do. Whatever you feel, it's fine. And he's always done it the same way. Let's go back. Genesis, the third chapter, the first verse. Genesis, the third chapter, the first verse, where it says, now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which Yahweh had made. And he said to the woman, is it so that God said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said to the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the middle of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat it. Neither shall you touch it. Whoa, whoa. When did he say that? I never found that. That's her little tip to Satan. She didn't realize she was tipping him off, but she was. Once you put in something that tells the other person how you feel, he now knows how to work with you. He knows how to manipulate you because he never said anything about touching it. Oh, he says, oh no, you should not eat of it, neither shall you even touch it. Ooh, she doesn't like that. We know how to go forward from here. Lest you die, verse 4. And the serpent said to the woman, now armed with all this new information, you shall not surely die. For God knows that in the day you eat of it, then your eyes shall be opened, and you shall be as God, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasing to the eyes, and the tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit. She also gave to her husband with her, and he ate. Notice where they said he was. Men through the centuries have always said, oh, he must have gotten there by himself. No. He was right there with him. Whip couldn't say nothing. If he'd said something, things might have been a little bit different. But notice it says, she also gave to her husband with her, and he ate. Because by now, the enticement is such, wow, you know, I was supposed to be watching her, but you know what? I'm almost wondering now, what's going to happen? Now notice, Satan always offers something that you will in time earn from Elohim. But Satan offers it before you're ready for it, convincing you that he's doing you a favor by giving it to you early with no strings attached. Knowing what his role would be if he were to successfully complete the mission he was sent on by the Father, Satan made the same offer to Yeshua Messiah. Title today, for those who keep such things, the world is mine. The world is mine. You know, so many Christians believe that Yeshua's life in the flesh was a done deal. They're even told that in some churches. They believe that he would have been allowed to return to the Father alive, whether he sinned or not. They believe that Yeshua's test was rigged in his favor. That the test was a done deal. He would have won no matter what. But this is not true. Yeshua very well could have sinned. It was possible for him to sin, and had he sinned, he would have failed. It was within the realm of possibility that he could have sinned, could have failed the test, and he would have died, and we would have no Savior. Don't kid yourselves. It was a possibility. But as one who did not sin, he qualified to die once for all who has ever lived. And all who call on his name, who do his will, who keep his commandments, who have their sins covered by his sacrifice, will live on as he has lived on, as he is our first fruits, on into eternity. The sinless life is the only reason, his sinless life is the only reason we have a chance to live on in the kingdom of God. There's nothing we can do to do it for ourselves. You see, Yeshua is our high priest. Hebrews, the 4th chapter, 14th verse. Hebrews, the 4th chapter, the 14th verse, where it says, since then we have a great high priest who has passed into the heavens, Yeshua, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession, for we do not have a high priest who cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted just as we are, but without sin. In other words, he went through, you know, what did he go through? What happened? Remember when they all came down to Abraham and they went to see Lot in Sodom? We know what happened to the angels that went to Lot's house. And we saw how they, men of Sodom, opened up the welcome wagon to them. But who was on the streets of Sodom, walking around? Who knows what he had to do to get away from these men? It says here, he was tempted in all ways as we are, yet did not sin, which means he didn't kill anybody, but he still got away from them intact. Yet so many don't fully understand all that Yeshua went through because they didn't understand it, because they didn't see it all. Well, when did that happen? He wasn't, well, you have to understand who was the God of the Old Testament. Once you come to that understanding, you see why it's not necessarily, if he says it in the Old Testament, to repeat it in the New. Oh, he didn't say anything about being gay. He said it in the Old Testament. That wasn't him, that was God. One day we will learn. One day we will learn that the book does not split in two. One day we will learn that those chapters and verses are not there to divide it into little pieces that you can take stand alone and say it means this. It's still all one book. But those chapters and verses are there so you can locate them more easily. Not so that you can isolate them and say, this has nothing to do with that. It all must come together or it doesn't work. It is what it is. But we have to understand he was there. He had the right and earned that right to become the sacrifice for us all and ultimately to reclaim in a more sure and stronger power his place at the right hand of the Father. We know what he went through at death, but note what he went through immediately after his baptism. At 30 years of age. Matthew, the third chapter, the 13th verse. Matthew, the third chapter, the 13th verse, which says, then Yeshua came from Galilee to Jordan, to John, to be baptized by him. But John restrained him, saying, I have need to be baptized by you. And do you come to me? And answering, Yeshua said to him, allow it now, for it is becoming to us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he allowed him. Now let's go to Luke, the third chapter, the 21st verse. Luke, the third chapter, the 21st verse. I know some of you have probably tried to read this on your own and thought, what is this all about? Let's try to get some understanding. Luke, the third chapter, starting at the 21st verse. And it happened in the baptizing of all the people, Yeshua also being baptized and praying, and the heaven was opened. And the Holy Spirit came down in a bodily shape like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven which is said, you are my son, the beloved. I am delighted in you. And Yeshua himself was beginning to be about 30 years of age, being, as was supposed, son of Joseph, son of Heli, son of Mattai, son of Levi, son of Melchi, son of Janna, son of Joseph, son of Mattathias, son of Amos, son of Nahum, son of Esli, son of Nagai, son of Maath, son of Mattathias, another. Son of Semai, son of Joseph, son of Judah, son of Joanna, son of Risa, son of Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, son of Neri, son of Melchi, son of Adai, son of Kosam, son of Elmodam, son of Er, son of Joses, son of Eliezer, son of Joram, son of Mattath, son of Levi, son of Simeon, son of Judah, son of Joseph, son of Jonan, son of Eliakim, son of Meliah, the son of Menan, son of Matata, of Nathan, son of David, son of Jesse, son of Obed, son of
Boaz. What?
Yeah. Son of Salma, son of Nashon, son of Aminadab, son of Ram, son of Hezron, son of Perez, son of Judah, son of Jacob, son of Isaac, son of Abraham, son of Terah, son of Hamor, son of Serug, son of Reu, son of Peleg, son of Eber, son of Shelah, son of Canaan, son of Arphaxad, son of Shem, son of Noah, son of Lamech, son of Methuselah, son of Enoch, son of Jared, son of Mahalalel, son of Canaan, son of Enos, son of Seth, son of Adam, son of God. Whoa. Now, if you do a thorough study of all the names in this genealogy of Mary, and again, go to the genealogy of Joseph in Matthew 1:1-31, not gonna go through that, do it on your own. You'll find some of the same names there. Why? You might even become very confused to find that Shealtiel and Zerubbabel are in both genealogies. But what is more important, you will find that between the two lists, the families, don't miss this, comprise members of every culture on the planet. Everyone. So don't say, oh, there's all people there. There is none missing. So although I remember for years they used to get mad when they found out about Boaz. And you go into the one in Matthew 1 and you'll find Rahab. Oh no, a whore? Yeah. This truth alone makes Yeshua uniquely qualified to die as the representative of every human being born on this planet. Who comes to him in sincere repentance for all of their sins, that incident that qualified him as planned from the dawn of creation. That event was the temptation Satan put him through immediately after his 40 days fast, directly after his baptism by his cousin, John the Baptist. You remember him, the baby that kicked in the womb. That's who that was. There was a connection from the beginning. God starts things from the beginning and finishes them at the end. That's how he knows the end from the beginning, and we don't. That's why we have to learn to question it. Fine, question it. But when the answer comes to you from here, good enough for me. Luke, the 4th chapter, the 1st verse. Luke, the 4th chapter, the 1st verse, where it says, and Yeshua, full of the Spirit, returned from Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, 40 days being tempted by the devil. And in those days he ate nothing. And they being ended, he afterward was hungry. And the devil always catches you at your weakest point. Notice that. Be aware of it. He always comes at you at the one time he knows that you're the weakest. Verse 3. And the devil said to him, if you are the Son of God, little tweak, if you will. He knew who he was. He was just tweaking, if you will. Take that word any way you want to, and you'll be right. He was tweaking. The devil said to him, if you are the Son of God, speak to this stone that it might become bread. You say this to a man that hasn't eaten in 40 days. And Yeshua answered him, saying, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. And the devil, leading him up into a high mountain, showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment in time. And the devil said to him, all this power I will give you, and the glory of them, for it has been delivered to me, and I give it to whomever I will. Now, many argue that Satan lacked the authority. You hear it all the time. Hey, how he's going to give him something that's not his? You hear it all the time. They say that he lacked the authority to offer anything to Yeshua. But let us see what the word says about that. Now, hold your finger here at Luke 4:6. We'll be coming back there. But let's go and look at some things. Ephesians, the second chapter, the first verse. Ephesians, the second chapter, the first verse, where it says, "In he has made you alive who were once dead in trespasses and sins, in which you once walked according to the course of this world." Some still do, but we'll keep that quiet. "According to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience." That spirit influencing and controlling the media and the governments of this world, and that spirit being Satan, the devil. Paul spoke of Satan's power on Mars Hill when he was speaking to the Areopagites, trying to convince them to convert to the truth of Yeshua. Acts, the 26th chapter, the 17th verse. Acts, the 26th chapter, the 17th verse, where it says, "Delivering you from the people and the nations to whom I now send you, in order to open their eyes so that they may turn from darkness to light." And from the authority of Satan, there it is again, whose authority is down here, from the authority of Satan to God, so that they may receive remission of sins and an inheritance among those who are sanctified by faith in me. Now let's go back to Luke, the 4th chapter, the 7th verse. "Therefore, if you will worship me, all shall be yours." And Yeshua answered and said to him, "Get behind me, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve." Now, let us notice something here in no uncertain terms. Satan is offering all of the political power of the world to Yeshua. He further states that it is his to give to whom he will. And let's be clear on this. Yeshua never argued that point. Because for this very battle was the one that determined who would be allowed to rule forever. Satan had co-opted a large number of the angels, and they rebelled with him. Satan then turned on the first humans and got them to rebel and doubt. This act resulted in the same insane violence and corruption that has been on the earth since the fall of Adam and Eve. Remember that little murder, the son killed Melon? Yeah. This doesn't start here. Once Satan once his rule comes forward, once he does his thing, the first thing people far figure, I can get more of what he's offering if that one's not here. And the first thing they'll do, stab. Now you've got all this great weaponry, now you can shoot. Heck, you got drones now. You can take a little remote and go to somebody in some other country and blow their house up and take their stuff. Same stuff, just different technology. Same evil mindset, same thing. We've reached that point where this is all we think to do, because it's the first thing that comes to our minds. Why? Because that's the first thing you see when you turn on that little evil box in your living room, dining room, on your phone now, on your iPad, on your whatever else you've got. He's coming at you from every different direction. And you want to say, oh, I don't, he doesn't have any influence on me. No, he owns you. You don't have to have the influence. You don't have to influence a goat. When the goat is living in your pen, on your farm, eating your food, drinking your drink, whose world is this? Him. He doesn't influence you. He owns you. And the only way he doesn't own you is if someone else does. Satan had co-opted everybody, sold everybody out. This is why there is such competitiveness and evil in all the world right now, because it's run by Satan, and he rules by violence. He rules by pressure. He rules by a competitive spirit. If you have a competitive spirit, you might want to check it again. And possibly, let's go back. Possibly, you might want to check it at the door. You see, if you notice, these are the ruling attitudes in the world today. It's the battle with Satan and Yeshua. If Yeshua were to sin, the plan of salvation would have been broken. As there would then have been no sacrifice worthy to offer up for the world. Many don't realize how important this exchange is in the world of faith. This battle is the key to our salvation. Had Yeshua lost, we would not have a Savior. Verse 9. And he brought him to Jerusalem and set him on a pinnacle of the temple and said to him, If you are the Son of God, cast yourself down from here, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge over you to keep you. And in their hands they shall bear you up, lest at any time you should dash your foot against a stone. And Yeshua answered and said to him, it has been said, if you shall not tempt the Lord your God. And when the devil had ended every temptation, he departed from him for a time. And the story ends in Matthew 4:11, where he says in Matthew 4:10, Yeshua answered, go away, Satan. The scripture says, worship the Lord your God and serve only him. Then the devil left Yeshua, and angels came to minister to him. It was at this point that Yeshua began to gather his disciples and begin his mission of salvation in earnest. Go to Matthew, the 4th chapter, 17th verse. Matthew, the 4th chapter, the 17th verse, where it says, from that time Yeshua began to preach and to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And walking by the Sea of Galilee, Yeshua saw two brothers, Simon called Peter, and Andrew his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. And they immediately left their nets and followed him. And going from there, he saw another two brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, in a boat with Zebedee, their father, mending their nets. And he called them, and they immediately left the boat and their father and followed him. And Yeshua went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, and preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing all kinds of sickness and all kinds of disease among the people. And his fame went throughout all Syria. And they brought to him all those being badly ill, suffering various diseases and torments, and those who had been possessed with demons, and those who had been moonstruck and paralytics, and he healed them. And great multitudes of people followed him from Galilee and Decapolis and Jerusalem and Judea and beyond Jordan. But you see, had Yeshua lost this great battle with Satan, Satan would have won. None of this would have been possible. The world would have been Satan's forever. And there would be no Savior to win the world back from him. And Satan still believes somehow that he can win this, that he can get by, that he can get the whole world to worship him, and God will become so upset that he will just throw his hands up and walk away and give it to him and create something else for himself. God doesn't work like that. God doesn't work like that. He's not God if he can't control what he created. But Satan still believes he can win. He wants the world to worship him, which is really all he wanted anyway. You're dealing with ego here, not dealing with intelligence. Oh, there might be some, but the larger mindset we're dealing with here is not intelligence, it's ego. It's all about me. He knows, however, that he only has a short time left. Yet, he still insanely believes that he can still win the universe away from the Almighty. And if not, at least he knows that he can keep many of us from ever being converted by the many false religions and the false philosophies extant on the earth right now. Earth is overwhelmed by them. And most believe on these things rather than the truth of Elohim. There is little true faith preached on Satan's airwaves. If you look, anybody that's looking for it already knows that. It's all about, if you watch television, it's all about getting rich. More and more books are talking about having faith, but without a God. You've seen it. Many are turning to the old pagan religions and trying to convince others to practice these. As a result, I was looking at some stats the other day. Halloween has become the second most profitable holiday in America. Guess what's number one? Got it. Christmas. Another one. Or, well, let's call it by its proper name, Saturnalia. Some people had taken to calling it Xmas. But when you turn it the right way, what is an X? It's a cross, which points you right back to. We don't think much, do we? We really don't think much. Oh, Xmas, what's Christ got to do with that? Amazing. Amazing. But it is what it is. There's not a lot that you can do about that, because people are going to believe because they've got all of these choices. We like choices in this world. We don't like to say, this is right, and we're going to stick with this no matter what. Even within the churches of God, you can be sailing along for years, believing, going along with everything, and then all of a sudden, something comes out of nowhere. We should be doing this by the moon. The Sabbath is a lunar thing. We don't have to do it all the time. Every maybe 3 months or 3 weeks out the month, that's all you need. And it doesn't have to be on Sunset Friday, Sunset Saturday. When it's done by the moon, it can float many different ways, many different days. You'd be amazed how many people are beginning to accept this, because it got its way into a couple of large denominations, and they're starting to pass it along to everybody else. First time I heard this was about 2 years ago or so. I read it through. If you really do it logically, if you read it the way they read it, the way they write it, well, gee, if you're following the moon, that means that you're following God's calendar. And if you're following God's calendar, that means that this is right. And this is the logic that people are using. It's not logical. Very early in the book, he says Sunset Friday to Sunset Saturday. And he didn't say every other one. He didn't say five off, three on. he gave this. So anything that doesn't fit the original order, there's got to be something wrong with it. But we like new. We like new. We like different. We like something they don't have, whoever they are. And that's what Satan's whole game is. If I can just get a few to buy into it and get the educated ones, because we think they're smarter than everybody else. He's got a PhD. He's got this. He's got that. What did Christ have? Thank you. It is what it is. But we like that imprimatur of high education. There's nothing wrong with education. Just don't put it in the place of Almighty God. That's all I'm saying. That's all I'm saying. Nothing else. We've got to get to that point where we understand all of this. This weekend is going to be rough for some of us, unless, of course, you like candy. There are a few in this generation, and understand, don't forget this. This is something that we may not believe because we're older. But there are people in this generation who don't even know how to act in church, because the only time they ever go are for weddings and funerals. It's the only time they would go put their foot in a church, if they go then. Sabbath schools are scarce. And most churches still teaching the word of God are largely populated by older, more seasoned, or serious believers. Don't feel bad. I'm up here just as old as you all are. I'm 57. It is what it is. Would like to be 57. Would like to be 58. 157. Would like to live on. That's the whole idea. That's what we're trying for. But if I'm still here at 80, if I can still get up here, I asked him, not knowing what condition he was in, and talking to him, didn't the pulsing mind completely betrayed the body. He finally got to a point and says, "Okay, I got to go. I'm missing up here, and I don't want to call. But talk to that man. Talk to him." There's so much going on there. There's so much knowledge there. There was so much going on there. And I'm sure even with what he delivered, we got something out of it. I'm sure of that. But that's what happens when you have older, more seasoned among us. Never discount that. Never discount that. Because it's going to get worse. Let me show you what the young can and will do for you. Notice what Isaiah says of these former days. In Isaiah, the 3rd chapter, the 4th verse. Isaiah, the 3rd chapter, the 4th verse, where it says, "And I will give children to be their princes, and babes shall rule over you. And the people shall be oppressed, every one by another, and every one by his neighbor. The children shall behave himself proudly against the ancient, and the base against the honorable. When a man shall take hold of his brother in the house of his father, saying, 'You have clothing, be our ruler. Let this ruin be under your hand.'" They know it's wrong. They know what they're doing is wrong, but they feel powerless to do anything about it. Say, "Hey, you take over. You take control. You be the one in charge. Let them blame you." That's what he's saying. Let them blame you. "I got nothing to do with this. I'm too weak to fight against it." Maybe you can. Verse 7. "In that day shall he lift up his voice, saying, 'I will not be an healer. For in my house is neither bread nor clothing. You shall not make me ruler of the people, for Jerusalem," or slap America in there, "is ruined. And Judah is fallen, because their tongue and their doings are against Yahweh."
to provoke the eyes of his glory. The show of their countenance or their face does witness against them, and they declare their sin as Sodom.
We've seen that all over. I don't even have to ask you. I'm sure you've seen it.
They hide it not. Woe unto their soul, for they have rewarded evil unto themselves. Say you to the righteous that it shall be well with them, for they shall eat the fruit of their doings.
Does anybody honestly think that we're getting these choices as leadership because we're doing this wonderful job for God? I don't. I think we're getting just what you got coming to you if we keep living the way we're living, doing the things we're doing, acting the way we're acting, selling what we're selling, buying what we're buying, giving away what we're giving away. We're getting what we've got coming, whatever that is. And when I say that, I'm not saying we are, but silence is consent. Anyone that's not whining and saying, hey, wait a minute, no, you're saying it's okay. It's what it is.
Woe, verse 11, woe unto the wicked, it shall be ill with him, for the reward of his hands shall be given him. As for my people, he comes right back home, children are their oppressors. Who's out in the streets oppressing? The gangs, the thugs. And women shall rule over them. O my people, they which lead you cause you to err and destroy the way of your paths. Those who lead you cause you to err and destroy the way of your paths. Yes, they do. You see it all around you. Few people will say that it is so. What are you left with here? A serial adulterer who can just barely keep his hands off his own daughter. And the corrupt women are the only, these two are the only choices you have for president? Gangs and corrupt police rule the streets. The death counts are higher in some cities than they are in some war zones. Yet, no one says they have a solution because no one wants the law of God or man enforced. At least not more forcefully they don't. After all, who would do it? With so little trust left for the police and the judicial system, who are they going to trust to do it? Truly, by the time the tribulation begins in earnest, most of the people of the world may welcome it. May welcome it because it will appear to be promising some level of stability. And definitely will promise an end to the violence in the streets as well as the lack of good food and water. Those who will take the mark of the beast will do so believing that they're doing it to save their lives. But most of the people that do this, for the most part, will be those of the world. At least we think so. Some of us may. It gets scary enough, you never know. That's why you don't make decisions when you're scared or when you're mad. You might make the wrong one. We must be aware of these verses that we've read here and begin to consider the elements of the tribulation to come. For you see, Satan confidently declares that the world is mine. And who lives in the world? So he's claiming us too. We got to let him know. No, you're not mine. This may be comforting for some, and it should definitely be comforting for we who obey the word of Elohim. But let's understand where we stand here, surely. A lot of people read this and don't see how important it is, but Revelation, the fifth chapter, the first verse. Revelation, the fifth chapter, the first verse, where it says, and I saw in the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the back, close sealed with seven seals. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a great voice, "Who is worthy to open the book and to loose the seals thereof?" And no one in the heaven or on the earth or under the earth was able to open the book or to look therein. And I wept much because no one was found worthy to open the book or to look thereon. And one of the elders said unto me, "Weep not. Behold, the Lion that is of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has overcome." What did we just read about? "Has overcome to open the book and the seven seals thereof. And I saw in the midst of the throne and of the four living creatures and in the midst of the elders, a lamb standing as though it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the world. And he came and he took it out of the right hand of him that sat on the throne. And when he had taken the book, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the lamb, having each one a harp and a golden bowl full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints." Question: are we praying for this world? Are we praying for our fellow brethren? That's what's going up. How do you say it? That's what's up. Verse 9. And they sing a new song, saying, "Worthy you are to take the book and to open the seals thereof, for you were slain and did purchase unto God with your blood men of every tribe and tongue and people and nation, and made them to be unto our God a kingdom and priests, and they reign upon the earth. And I saw and I heard a voice of many angels round about the throne and the living creatures and the elders, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000, thousands of thousands, an innumerable number, saying with a great voice, 'Worthy is the Lamb that has been slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing, and every created thing which is in the heaven and on the earth and under the earth and on the sea and on the things that are in them.' Heard I say, 'Unto him that sits on the throne and unto the Lamb be the blessing and the honor and the glory and dominion forever and ever.' And the four living creatures said, 'Amen.' And the elders fell down and worshiped." He just told you why he did it. And he told you what our position would be coming into this tribulation if we remain strong in him. What have we got to worry about? Am I saying don't worry? No. There's going to be plenty to worry about in the coming months. But know that if we remain in this word, not my word, this word, we'll be all right. No matter what happens, all this that'll go on, all we have to do is continue to pray, fast, love each other, keep the commandments of Elohim, and remain obedient to his word. And he has already set a place for all who remain in him, in his kingdom. The world may seem to belong to Satan, but Yeshua will lead all who remain with him into the leadership and co-ownership of the universe. Let us remain in his will, because from that place, we have nothing to fear. And eventually, we will be able to say, the world is his. God bless you all.